Well, okay, the recording has started and we continue with what we had stopped at last time. And this was the last slide, I suppose, that irrigation has played a very important role in agriculture. All the way back from, say, around 10,000 years ago, wherein agriculture as a practice had just started and man started getting sedimentary, started cultivating a few selective crops, and 1,000 years down the line, he started actually, say, placing them in order, and they didn't know they had very primitive tools, okay, in the Mesolithic and the Neolithic ages, as it is said. And they poked holes in the surface, and having poked hole in the surface, they used to lay the seeds into those holes, and that is how cultivation took place. A few more 1,000 years down the line, and man invented the plow, and the plow brought about a lot of changes, basically because of the fact that now the land could be opened up. Okay, the hardened land could now be opened up. And agriculture could be practiced in other areas also. Now, if you remember, this is not there in the text of the section that I have posted you. Earlier, agriculture was limited to river banks and flood plains, basically because of the softness of the surface, and agriculture could not carry on beyond river flood plains. That was the major reason being that you did not have equipments to open up these surfaces, but they were soft enough only in the flood plains. And as a consequence, for a few 1,000 years during this particular period, you will see that agriculture was limited to river flood plains. And that's why you'll see that civilizations were limited to banks of major rivers. It could be the Egyptian civilization, it could be the Indus civilization, it could be the Wanghoo civilization, and so on and so forth. But you'll see that with the help of the plow, initially it was pulled as far as initially it was pulled by human beings themselves, but then man learned to domesticate draught animals, and then he tied these animals. Of course, the draught animals tied to the plows change from area to area. Okay, you'll find them in certain areas, and as a consequence, you'll see that from bullocks in India. Okay, you'll find in southern parts of India, you'll find buffaloes. In the northern parts of India, it could go to camels and yaks, etc., in different parts of the world. But the sheer strength of these animals helped man to pull the plow through hardened surfaces, and that is how agriculture started spilling over from flood banks or river banks to other parts also. That was a very interesting development, and that's why the plow becomes very, very important. Okay, similar innovations took place as far as irrigation is concerned, but you'll see that the comparative innovations after Industrial Revolution is much different to what it was in the first few 1,000 years of the agricultural history. As such, in spite of the fact, you'll see that this is called as agricultural revolution because of the fact that man settled down as into the activity of agriculture. That's why it's called also called as the sedentary agriculture. Once you planted a particular tree or a particular crop, you had to stay there and take care, and that's why you'll see that man gradually moved away from hunting and gathering. And he settled down into agriculture because he was tied to that particular land, piece of land. And as a consequence, you'll see that civilization started growing because human civilization needed to be supported by other activities as far as associated with agriculture was concerned. So that is how it progressed, and you'll see that not much changes took place because the population also did not grow that much, and as a consequence, not much area was required to be brought under cultivation. Yes, there could have been phases wherein you had diseases, you had famines, you had floods, and that could have had impacted. But if you compare this to this phase to the demographic transition model, the birth rates and the death rates being high, the populations never increased, so the surfaces were not stressed for the cultivation of agricultural practices as such. Then you'll see that through the history, there has been a difference between botanists and so to say archaeologists as to from where did agriculture particularly come up. And as a consequence, we have different views of different people, right from Saur to Vavilov, and who was a botanist, by the way. And then you had Cecil, and you had Joseph Wadsworth, who spoke about different areas, different possible areas wherein agriculture could have originated. And you'll see that as time goes by, these researchers start speaking about various other crops rather than only, so to say, the cereal crops as such. Okay, and then we come to a very interesting system which is practiced, which later on was practiced in India also, though it is not, I would say, openly practiced, said to be openly practiced in India. But you'd see that even today, a similar type of activity does produce, continue, and that's called as the Zamindari system. This in English is referred to as the feudal system. And it came up in France in the 12th century, wherein you had a particular person who, a landlord, used to own a particular land, and people used to work on this feudal system. And this continued for the next 2 to 3 centuries. But by the 16th century, feudal system had disappeared from Europe. But it had come up in other parts of the world as such. But what happened after 17th century was something very, I would say, revolutionary again, that touched the sense of agricultural practice for the world. It obviously started from Europe first, and that was the Industrial Revolution. It brought about the use of machines, I would say, as far as agricultural practice was concerned. You shifted to iron plows, and that again, as if you see earlier, different machines were used and different methods were invented for plowing and sowing and threshing and of course harvesting as such. Okay, and with all these things, one thing that changed the face of agriculture was the use of chemical fertilizers. Before that, not much of chemical fertilizers were used. Most of the fertilizers were in the form of manure and organic fertilizers. It was only during and onwards from the Industrial Revolution that chemical fertilizers started being used as such. Okay, and because of an external supply of fertilizer, you'll see that the practice of fallowing also could be done away with. Now, the reason that we had to do away with the practice of fallowing is because by the Industrial Revolution, the birth rates were maintained to be high, but the death rates started falling down, and thus the population of the world, initially of course Europe, and then the world started increasing like anything. And as a consequence, new areas needed to be brought under net sown or say cultivation as such. Marshy areas, wastelands started to be reclaimed by the use of various machines and scientific methods. And this led to a lot of increased production, and this increased production now could feed increased populations as such. And that is how you would say that the Industrial Revolution complemented growth of production in agriculture, and this increased production, growth of production in agriculture complemented, I would say, Industrial Revolution, because Industrial Revolution required a lot of labor, and this labor came into urban areas from villages. Okay, and that's why you'll see that people started moving from rural areas to migrating from rural areas to urban areas. This is how agriculture has been growing. Okay, and then you'll see that Industrial Revolution further brought new innovations in the form of transport and communication. And because of that, that gives rise to a new system of agriculture, and this was plantation agriculture. Okay, you'll see that through the phase of colonialism in history, you'll see that these Europeans, they occupied various regions in the tropical and the subtropical regions, equatorial regions, and they started cultivating these areas because of the favorable climate and the regular supply of rainfall, etc. They started cultivating this for products that were required in their countries. That's the European markets as such. And to make this profitable, obviously, you had to grow this on a very massive scale. And this massive scale came to be called as plantation agriculture, initially starting with the beverage crops like tea and coffee, and then the other industrial crops like rubber. And all these was practiced on a very, as I said, massive scale. This massive scale, and of course the associated practices like use of say management systems, the staff there, you're having a manager, and then you have people who are under him, and they take orders from him, and they work in these fields. The technical knowledge that they use, various types of agricultural implements and machineries, of course, not to forget the chemical fertilizers, and of course the use of chemical insecticides and pesticides. Add to this the transport facilities. They brought about huge development as far as production is concerned. But the amount of these products that were required in the European markets required huge areas to be occupied, and that's why these were called as plantation agriculture. As time passed by, they shifted from rubber, tea, coffee to cocoa and then sugarcane, because sugar was something that was again required. Of course, you see that plantation agriculture did not affect much of sugarcane cultivation in India. But if you go to the West Indies and Cuba, etc., as such, you will see that sugarcane was cultivated on a plantation scale so that sugar could be exported to, say the European markets as such. The same thing happened with cotton, jute, and of course, fruit plantations like banana and apple and so on and so forth. Okay, this then followed, in history, it was followed by the First World War and then the Second World War. And it was during the Second World War that you had the Russian Revolution, and Russia with its dream, the communist Russia, then communist Russia, okay, USSR, I should be calling it, because today's Russia is minus the, the confederation states of Turkmenistan and Uzbekistan and Kazakhstan, which all were under the control of then USSR. So the revolution brought about a lot of change as far as Russian agriculture was concerned. Two basic things that came into Russian or the communist Russian agriculture were collective farms, what they which were called as kolkhozes, and the peasants were made to say the peasants who were working under the so-called feudal system in Russia then, they were made the owners of the land. आपल्याकडे कसेल त्याची जमीन हा कायदा जसा आला तसाच तिकडे सुद्धा आला. अँड द गव्हर्नमेंट वॉन्टेड दीज पीपल टू वर्क इन अ कोऑपरेटिव्ह मॅनर. अँड यू सी दॅट दीज कलेक्टिव्ह फार्म्स हॅड मॅनेजर्स हू वर अपॉइंटेड बाय द गव्हर्नमेंट, अँड द एंटायर प्रोडक्शन वॉज टू बी सोल्ड टू द स्टेट ॲट द फिक्स्ड प्राइस. ऑफकोर्स दे यूज टू announce that okay, this much amount of area should give us this much amount of food grains at this much amount of rate. If you could produce food or agricultural produce beyond that, you could obviously sell it into the international into the market beyond the government procurement, and the profit was divided between the farmers and the managers, etc., etc. The equipments required for these farms were available at what were called as tractor stations, and the manager could hire these and so on and so forth. And while this happened with people, you'll see that the state itself also came up with agricultural practices, and you'll see that these were huge in size, and you had hundreds of people working on these farms, literally employed as government employees, and that's why they were called as the state land. It was cultivated on state land, and that's why they were called as state farms as such. Okay, and you had a significant number of sheep and cattle and goats on these farms who were reared for their own products also. Then you'll see that the Second World War ended, and then in history we see that a lot of colonial countries became independent, and their population started to grow, and the 50s and the early 60s had difficult times, and it was only in 1966 that the new miracle seed, as it was called, was invented in Mexico. The high HYV, the high yielding variety seed, and this changed the face of agriculture, particularly in the developing countries. Yes, it definitely changed the face of agriculture in developed countries, but you'll see that the problems that the developing and underdeveloped countries were facing, the high growth in population, and however, the low growth in agriculture, and this was coupled with problems of famines at times. Particularly in countries like India, you'll see that regions like Bihar, etc., faced dual problems, at times that of floods, and at times that of famines. And as a consequence, you will see that what happened is there was a dearth of food supply as far as the population was concerned, and the world was looking around for something like these high yielding variety seeds. Not only did these seeds yield high, but the total period of time that they came for harvest, the crop came for harvest, was also reduced considerably, and as a consequence, you'll see that productions went up significantly. You can see here that from a mere 11 million tons of wheat that was produced in 60-61, it went up to around 99, around 2000 to 75 million in India alone. So you'll see that similar things happened in different parts of the world as well. However, you'll see that there were two requirements as far as the HYV seeds of wheat were concerned: heavy doses of chemical fertilizers, and they required a huge amount of irrigation. So only those parts of India which were under a regular supply of irrigation could prosper on Green Revolution, and that indicated the Punjab part of northern India, which included the present state of Punjab, Haryana, and of course the western parts of Uttar Pradesh. Okay, all the rivers that started in the Himalayas, along which these major dams came up. And because of these dams, the water could be harvested for irrigation purposes. And as a consequence, wheat came to be a staple crop of North India, and it stays to be a staple crop of North India. Punjab is called as the granary of India, the earlier Punjab, that was Punjab plus Haryana. Later you'll see that the original Punjab split into Punjab and Haryana and so on and so forth. So that is how the Green Revolution brought about changes as far as Indian agriculture was concerned. Having said that, a significant amount of agriculture even today in India stays to be practiced as rain-fed agriculture, okay, or dryland agriculture as such. Okay, rain-fed in the sense that the crop depends only and exclusively on rainwater. There is no irrigation. So that's the difficulty as far as India is concerned. However, day by day, irrigation projects are coming up and new areas are coming under agricultural practices. But the problem is that when you have to come up with an irrigation project, you have to actually build a dam. आणि मग धरण बांधायचं म्हटल्यावर the dam occupies an area, isn't it? And as a consequence, you have to displace people. Now, this could be hundreds of villages, this could be tribal people, this could be cutting down of forests and all that. And that is why the new aspect of all these problems comes up, in the sense, ज्याला आपण प्रकल्पग्रस्त लोक अशी आपण म्हणतो. प्रकल्पग्रस्त लोकांना मग हे प्रकल्प थोडंसं डायग्रेस होत आहे, पण हे जे प्रकल्प असतात ते धरणग्रस्त असतील किंवा आजकाल आता रस्ते बांधणी असेल तर त्याचा प्रकल्प असेल, असे अनेक प्रकल्प शासन हाती घेत असतं. आणि अशा प्रकल्पग्रस्त लोकांना वेगवेगळ्या सुविधा दिल्या जातात. त्यातली एक म्हणजे इंडस्ट्रीयल MIDC जेव्हा हे झाल्या त्याच्यामध्ये सुद्धा प्रकल्पग्रस्त लोक आहेतच. आणि इनफॅक्ट ज्या MIDC आता ज्या हेतूने सुरू केल्या होत्या तेवढ्या मोठ्या त्या वाढल्या नसतील, तर अशा झोनमधल्या लोकांनी त्यांची जमीन परत मागायला सुरू केलेली आहे. तसंच धरणाच्या क्षेत्रात सुद्धा प्रकल्पग्रस्त शेतकरी असतातच. सो दिस इज अनदर ऍस्पेक्ट ॲज फार ॲज द सोशल, अनदर सोशल ऍस्पेक्ट. आणि वेन वी स्पीक अबाउट द सोशल इम्पॅक्ट, वी आर गोइंग टू स्पीक अबाउट दॅट ॲज वेल. Having said this, it's not only India in which these HYV seeds reach to bring up the Green Revolution. You'll see that right from Pakistan to, that's East and West Pakistan initially, now Pakistan and Bangladesh, all the way to Turkey, Philippines, Indonesia, Malaysia, Sri Lanka and Philippines. Okay, you'll see that these countries use, of course, not all of them used it for wheat, some used it for rice, and some used it for wheat as such. Okay, now you'll see that Green Revolution, we have already said, and we are going to do it in detail when we move ahead. This is just the introductory part to the history of agriculture. I would say that India could not derive adequate benefits from rice miracle seeds, probably because of two reasons: the Indian environment and the supply and drainage of water could not be exercised properly. Apan pahato ki bhat sheti sathi prachanda pramanat paus lagto. And secondly, you'll see that the supply of water in Indian conditions, particularly the southern part, northern parts, it was difficult to cultivate rice because rice could not replace wheat, which had established itself in the northern parts of India. In the southern parts, you'll see that bringing that much amount of water, upon pahatoch ki bhat shetila prachanda pramanat pani lagta. Okay, and that's why you'll see that though both projects started simultaneously, that for wheat and rice, you'll see that not much is spoken about. In fact, it came up for other crops also, but you'll see that besides wheat, which was a perfect crop which match the Indian environment. Not even rice, as a matter of fact, could match the development of wheat as a crop in India. And that's why you'll see that Green Revolution for rice as a crop was not a success, that much a success as compared to rice. Yes, we did have a success in some parts, that's towards the deltas of the southern rivers of the Tungabhadra and the Godavari and the Krishna and the Kaveri as such. But because rice required a lot of water, and we did not have irrigation supplies, and of course we did not have that much amount of water supply in the southern parts of India, rice did not succeed as such. And after 70s, you would say that new types of problems came up in promotion of agriculture, in the sense the failure of monsoon in 1972, because India is heavily dependent on the monsoon rain, and that's why we also call it as dryland agriculture, except for those small patches which are cultivated through irrigation. Then we started experiencing shortage of fertilizers, and this was experienced globally because of because fertilizers, chemical fertilizers, are associated with oil refineries, okay, oil in the sense crude oil refineries as such. And you'll see that if you have read history, again you'll see that around in the 70s the prices of these fuels were hiked up, and as a consequence you'll see that all associated prices went up and availability of fertilizers, chemical fertilizers, went down. And because you'll see that if chemical fertilizers were not available, then there definitely was a problem with the application of high yield variety seeds, because it was compulsory that use of chemical fertilizers in a liberal sense was to be practiced where you were cultivating your crop using high yield variety seeds. Okay, but the prices went up, and you'll see that there was a difficulty as far as the further success of Green Revolution was concerned. Another thing is that we already spoke that it requires a lot of irrigation. So where canal irrigation was not possible, you could use well irrigation, tube well irrigation, but these tube wells required electric energy. So we'll see that when in those times, in 70s, most of the electricity was produced out of these huge irrigation projects or huge dams. Now, with the failure of monsoon, the water levels in these dams were low. As a consequence, not only was less available water available for irrigation, you'll see that electricity production was also low. As a consequence, all this hampered and had Green Revolution had difficulties during the decade of the 70s as such. Then you'll see that once again around 1998, there was an increase in diesel and petrol prices, and as a consequence you'll see that countries had to turn to organic manures, biofertilizers, and look for new sources of energy also. Okay, it is felt that Green Revolution in agriculture has also created social tensions, and that's very obvious in India. Okay, it has led to economic as well as social disparity between smaller and big farmers as such. It can be pointed out that excessive agriculture has also created problems like waterlogging, and thus has led to land pollution. Okay, so these are the difficulties that are associated with the Green Revolution as such. And of late there have been further changes, but then we'll just finish off these points. In case of chemical fertilizers, we'll see that the adverse comment in relation to the environment is that excess fertilizers is washed away from the fields to river ponds, and these get polluted because it leads to what is called as eutrophication. Now, what exactly does eutrophication mean? And of course, this is, I would again not blame the fertilizer, even though it is chemical, I won't blame the fertilizer used as such. But you'll see that this is more to be blamed with regards the habit of human beings as such. Okay, you'll see that if you look at other animals, they don't store things around them. Okay, म्हणजे होर्डिंग करत नाहीत ते एखाद्या गोष्टीचं. युट्रोफिकेशन, माणसाला सगळ्या गोष्टी गोळा करायची, गरजेपेक्षा जास्त जमा करून ठेवायची फार घाणेरडी सवय आहे. याची की अगदी तुम्ही पाहाल की वेगवेगळे प्राणी, फॉर एक्झाम्पल अस्वल असेल किंवा जी वॉल्रसेस किंवा व्हेल्स किंवा सील्स असतील, दीज ॲनिमल्स ग्रो अ फॅट अराउंड देम ओनली फॉर अ सीझन. पण माणसाचं कसं असतं, ह्या वर्षीचंच नाही, मला पुढची 5 वर्ष, पुढची 10 वर्ष. आपलं इकॉनॉमिक प्लॅनिंग बघा सुद्धा कसे असतात, 5-year plan, 10-year plan. सिंह, हत्ती वगैरे आणि इनफॅक्ट अदरवाईज ऑल्सो डोमेस्टिकेटेड ॲनिमल्स लाईक द कॅटल इन द फॉर्म ऑफ काऊज एक्सेट्रा, गोट्स एक्सेट्रा, दे डोंट थिंक ऑफ ऑल दीज थिंग्स, दे लीव इट ऑल टू द नेचर. बट यू सी दॅट मॅन हू हॅज ऑलवेज ट्राईड टू बी इन कंट्रोल ऑफ नेचर, के यू सी ki he in economic sense he will speak in terms of long term plans, short term plans, and India has been working on 5-year plans as such. Ke 5 varshachi planning tumhi karta hai mhatlyavar you would be planning for resources to the gauge of those 5 years and so on and so forth. Coming back to this very point, what happens is because of this, okay, there is a human tendency की जेवढं आपण जास्त टाकू तेवढं आपलं प्रोडक्शन जास्त होईल. तर when they started using, farmers started using fertilizers in their fields, chemical fertilizers particularly, and of course the fact that these fertilizers were subsidized by the government as such, मला त्याचं झळ बसत नव्हती त्या कॉस्टची, तेवढी म्हणावी तेवढी. एक असा समज होता की मी जेवढं फर्टिलायझर टाकीन तेवढं मोठं, तेवढं जास्त प्रोडक्शन येईल. बट ॲज पर ग्रोथ ऑफ क्रॉप्स इज कन्सर्न, दे आर गोइंग टू गो बाय से नॅचरल लॉज. सो इफ आय एम गोइंग टू पोर इन 100 grams ऑफ फर्टिलायझर इन अ पर्टिक्युलर फील्ड अँड पॉसिबली ओनली 40 grams ऑफ दोज 100 grams आर गोइंग टू बी युटिलाइज फॉर ग्रोथ ऑफ प्लांट्स, ग्रोथ ऑफ दॅट पर्टिक्युलर क्रॉप, द रेस्ट ऑफ द 60 grams of fertilizer is going to stay there. Kuni te asa jhad asa manasa sarkha vichar karat nahi ki ata mala he pudhcha varshi sathi thiu de, tyacha pudhcha varshi sathi thiu de, tanna jevda hava ahe tevdas te ghenar ahet. So 60% 60 grams of these fertilizers are going to be staying there. Ata what happens is when you have the next rain, these fertilizers mixed in the rain water and they go into nearby water bodies, okay, they go into rivers, they go into ponds. Now you'll see that what do fertilizers do? Fertilizers basically enhance the growth, biotic growth as such. The ya panyamade sudha je algae ahe, okay, mag te river water asu de kiwa pond water asu de, ki apan hi ji jalaparani bagto aajkal, ki mala vatta aaj Times of India la kasa sakala त्या भिडे पुलावर किती जलपर्णी जमा झालेली आहे, की ती सगळी वाहून आली तिकडे अडकलेली आहे. तर अशी ही जलपर्णी आणि इतर जी वीड्स असतात, की दे ग्रो बेसिकली बिकॉज ऑफ दीज फर्टिलायझर्स डिझॉल्विंग इन सर्फेस वॉटर अँड कमिंग ऑल द वे डाऊन इन टू दीज स्टीम्स अँड पॉन्ड्स. The water gets enriched with fertilizer qualities and as a consequence there is a proliferation, म्हणजे प्रचंड वेगाने algae ची growth जी आहे ती वाढते आणि as a consequence what happens is जे ज्याला आपण पारदर्शक पाणी, transparent water म्हणतो, because of this green growth, it starts growing greener and greener and greener, this and further enhances the algae growth in the in the river body, and as a consequence, gradually this water becomes unfit. Okay, and this process of say enrichment of water, okay, in the negative sense, of course, enrichment of water with chemical fertilizers and leading to a very fast growth rate of algae and consequently water weeds, okay, in a particular area is called as eutrophication, and this has become a very common problem. You'll see that major rivers of India are faced with this particular problem. Currently we are using a lot of excessive fertilizers which get washed up into the waters of these rivers as such. Similarly, you'll see that a major comment on is on insecticides and pesticides also, that they are used to save the crop from serious loss due to insecticides as such. It is pointed out that insecticides and pesticides pollute the atmosphere and are dangerous for humans as well. Actually, ithe त्या पुस्तकामध्ये नाही आहे, बट यू कॅन रिमेंबर दॅट जस्ट लाईक टू युट्रिफिकेशन देर इज समथिंग कॉल्ड एज बायो मॅग्निफिकेशन म्हणजे तुम्ही कितीही नाही म्हटलं की नाही आमचं इन्सेक्टिसाईड हे केमिकल नाही आहे आणि असं नाही आहे आणि ते काय तुमच्या तुम्हाला हार्म करत नाही, यु सी दॅट आणि ते त्या पर्टिक्युलर क्रॉपला हार्म करत नाही. These are all misleading statements. तुम्ही जेव्हा एखादं केमिकल स्प्रे करता, तुम्ही पाहता आजकाल आपण हँड सॅनिटायझर्स वापरतोय आणि काही लोक जे ते अतिप्रमाणात वापरत आहेत त्यांना स्किन प्रॉब्लेम्स होत आहेत अँड सो ऑन अँड सो फोर्थ. ही तर आत्ताशी एक सुरुवात आहे. आपण जितकं वापरू हँड सॅनिटायझर आणि ते जितकं अतिप्रमाणात वापरूयात त्याचं हळूहळू जसा जसा अभ्यास होईल, रिसर्च होईल, यू विल कम अप विथ डिफरंट केस स्टडीज ॲज सच. द सिमिलर थिंग हॅपन्स विथ इन्सेक्टिसाइड्स अँड पेस्टिसाइड्स, की तुम्ही इन्सेक्ट्स आणि पेस्ट्स मारायला हे केमिकल वापरता खरं, पण एकदा का तुम्ही ते शेतावर स्प्रे केलं की त्याची थोडी का होईना मात्रा ही तुमच्या त्या जो क्रॉप आहे त्याच्यामध्ये उतरणार आहे आणि दॅट टेंड्स टू बी कॅरीड ऑल द वे टू द हार्वेस्ट ऑल्सो. आणि मग ती आपण जी फूड चेन म्हणतो त्या फूड चेनमधनं पास होत ती पुढे पुढे सरकत राहते आणि हे पुढे सरकण्याचं एक विशिष्ट प्रमाण आहे. इफ यू रिमेंबर, तुम्ही हे एन्व्हायरमेंटमध्ये केलं असेल तर एनर्जी ट्रान्सफर जी आहे, की पहिल्या लेवलला जर 100 युनिटची एनर्जी आली तर 90% एनर्जी ही वापरली जाते आणि पुढच्या लेवलला 10% एनर्जी सोडली जाते. तिथून पुढच्या लेवलला म्हणजे हे जर हर्बीवोरस असेल, हे ओमनिवोरस असेल आणि सो ऑन अँड सो फोर्थ, हे पुढचं प्रोड्युसर्स कन्झ्युमर्स हे तुम्ही केलं असेल तर 100 युनिटची एनर्जी पुढच्या लेवलला जेव्हा जातात, ऑटोट्रॉफिक लेवल म्हणतात त्याला, 90% हे स्वतः ठेवून घेतात आणि 10% पुढे पाठवतात आणि मग या 10%मधली 90% पुन्हा ठेवून घेणार, म्हणजे 9 युनिट ठेवून घेणार आणि 1% पुढे पाठवणार, 1 युनिट पुढे पाठवणार, 1% नाही 10% पुढे पाठवणार, 1 युनिट पुढे येणार. एक्झॅक्टली ऑपोजिट होतं जेव्हा यू आर युझिंग समथिंग दॅट इज नॉट अ नॅचरल सिस्टम, दॅट इज नॉट इन द नॅचरल सिस्टम, इन द सेन्स की तुम्ही जर 100 ग्रॅम इन्सेक्टिसाइड, आता हे सगळं हायपोथेटिकल आहे पण हे बायोमॅग्निफिकेशन म्हणजे नेमकं काय हे समजायचं असेल तर हे मी थोडेसे हायपोथेटिकल नंबर्समध्ये समजवतो. एनर्जीच्या बाबतीत कसं आहे की एनर्जी वॉज युजफुल टू द प्लांट्स ऑर दॅट पर्टिक्युलर लेवल, सो जास्तीत जास्त ठेवून घेतलेला आहे. पेस्टिसाइड्स आणि इन्सेक्टिसाइड्स हे त्यांच्या कामाचे नाही, हे ह्युमन बिईंग्सनी तयार केलेले आहेत आणि त्यांच्या फायद्यासाठी वापरल्यामुळे की दे विल नॉट कीप बॅक द इन्सेक्टिसाइड्स अँड पेस्टिसाइड्स. तर 100 ग्रॅममधला फक्त 10 ग्रॅम इथे वापरला जाईल आणि 90 ग्रॅम हे पुढं जाणार आहे. ओके, आणि अजून पुढे जाईल तर तुम्ही पहा की याच्यातले पुन्हा याची कॉन्सन्ट्रेशन किती वाढणार आहे, की बाय द टाइम इट रिचेस अ पर्टिक्युलर लेवल इट इज हायली कॉन्सन्ट्रेटेड आणि इट विल अक्युम्युलेट इन अ पर्टिक्युलर लेवल आणि द कॉन्सन्ट्रेशन, दिस इज नॉट अबाउट द ग्रॅम्स, की यू विल सी की एखाद्या लेवलमध्ये याचं कॉन्सन्ट्रेशन हळूहळू वाढत जाणार आहे आणि मग त्या प्रजातीमध्ये तुम्हाला ते इन्सेक्टिसाइड किंवा केमिकल जे आहे, पेस्टिसाइड म्हणा इन्सेक्टिसाइड म्हणा, ते जास्त प्रमाणात आढळायला लागतं आणि दॅट दॅट क्रिएट्स अ व्हेरी सिरियस प्रॉब्लम. अँड दिस होल इश्यू इज कॉल्ड अज बायोमॅग्निफिकेशन. एखाद्या प्राणी मात्रामध्ये हे वेगवेगळ्या स्तरातून येणारं जे केमिकल आहे ते जमा होणं, याचं एक अतिशय सुंदर उदाहरण अतिशय जुन्या काळापासून दिलं जातं. 50 वर्षापूर्वी अमेरिकेत 3 आईज म्हणून स्टेट आहे, इलिनॉइस, इडाहो आणि आयोवा, असे 3 नॉर्दर्न ह्याच्यामध्ये USA हे स्टेट्स आहेत. दे आर नोन फॉर मेज कल्टिवेशन, मक्याचे कल्टिवेशनच्या इथे म्हणून ते ओळखलं जाते. या मक्याच्या ह्याच्यावर एक पिक्युलर प्रमाणात इन्सेक्टिसाइड मारलं जायचं. आता हे ठीक आहे, ते कीटक मरायचे खरे, पण हे कीटक जे आहेत हे तिकडचे पक्षी खायचे. ओके, सो यू सी की फ्रॉम द क्रॉप टू द इन्सेक्ट अँड फ्रॉम द इन्सेक्ट टू द बर्ड. आता काय व्हायचं की हे केमिकल त्या बर्डच्या अंगात अक्युम्युलेट व्हायचं, ओके, किंवा मॅग्निफाय व्हायचं, जमा होत राहायचं आपण असं म्हणूया. अँड ॲज अ कॉन्सिक्वेन्स अ सिरियस प्रॉब्लम स्टार्टेड अकरिंग. आता हा प्रॉब्लेम कसा लक्षात आला ॲग्रिकल्चरिस्टच्या, की त्यांनी पाहिलं की हे पक्षी पूर्वी एक मदत म्हणून पाहिलं जायचं ह्यांना शेतकऱ्यांचे, कारण ते किडे खायचे, पण ते किडे लवकर मारावेत म्हणून मी इन्सेक्टिसाइड पेस्टिसाइड मारायला सुरू केलं. आणि ह्यांना सडनली कळलं की आता हे पक्षी जे आहेत हे आपल्याला कमी दिसायला लागलेले आहेत. तर मग झुओलॉजिस्ट लोकांनी याच्यावर अभ्यास केला, त्यांनी असं पाहिलं की हे जे केमिकल वापरलं जायचं इन्सेक्टिसाइडमध्ये, की ह्या केमिकलमुळे हे केमिकल हळूहळू डाऊन द लाईन सरकत सरकत पक्ष्यांमध्ये यायचं, आणि त्यामुळे त्यांची जी अंडी असायची त्या अंड्याचं कवच जे असायचं हे अतिशय काय म्हणू आपण त्याला बारीक थिकनेसचं असायचं यायला लागलं. कारण या केमिकलने असे काही चेंजेस केले त्यांच्या बॉडीमध्ये की जी अंडी घालायची ते पक्षी त्याचं कवच जे होतं हे अतिशय बारीक थिकनेसचं झालं, आणि थोडंसुद्धा काही झालं तर ते तिथल्या तिथं फुटायचं. ओके, ॲज अ कॉन्सिक्वेन्स ह्यांचा नंबर जो आहे हा ड्रॅस्टिकली कमी व्हायला लागला. आणि हे सगळं पाहिल्यावर मग तिकडच्या गव्हर्नमेंटला जाग आली आणि मग तो इन्सेक्टिसाइड जो आहे तो बॅन करण्यात आला वगैरे वगैरे ते सगळं झालं. बट दिस इज जस्ट वन एक्झाम्पल. यू सी दॅट फूड चेनमध्ये असे अनेक एक्झाम्पल्स आहेत की याच्यामुळे ते त्याच्यामुळे ते. मला आठवतं की भारतामध्ये सुद्धा एक अशी एक स्टोरी आहे की गँजेटिक प्लेनमध्ये, आता ओझडतं मला आठवतं आहे, हे मी वाचलेलं आहे ते आता हे नेमकं कुठं वाचलेलं आहे मला माहीत नाही, पण गिधाडं जे आहेत त्यांचं पॉप्युलेशन हे त्या एरियामध्ये गँजेटिक प्लेनमध्ये जास्त होतं, आणि ते गिधाडांचं पॉप्युलेशन सडनली खाली गेलं बिकॉज ऑफ यूज ऑफ इन्सेक्टिसाइड्स अँड पेस्टिसाइड्स इन दॅट ॲग्रिकल्चरल बेल्ट. आपण जो ग्रीन रेव्होल्युशन बेल्ट म्हणतो आहे भारताचा, तिथेच हे सगळं आहे. बट आय एम नॉट व्हेरी शुअर अबाउट दिस. मला हे लिंकमध्ये मला हे सापडलं ह्याचा डॉक्युमेंट, तर मी निश्चित वाचून पुन्हा त्याचं एक्झाम्पल हे देईन. आणि दिस हे तरी 70s अमेरिकेत झालं, गिधाडांची स्टोरी ही गेल्या 2 दशकातली भारतातलीच आहे. सो बायोमॅग्निफिकेशन इज अ सिरियस इम्प्लिकेशन ऑफ यूज ऑफ सिरियस ॲडवर्स इम्प्लिकेशन ऑफ द यूज ऑफ इन्सेक्टिसाइड्स अँड पेस्टिसाइड्स, केमिकल इन्सेक्टिसाइड्स अँड पेस्टिसाइड्स ऑल अराउंड द वर्ल्ड ऑल्सो. देन यू सी की ह्या सगळ्या गोष्टींमुळे काय होतं, तर इट पल्युट्स द एन्व्हायरमेंट अँड इट डिस्टर्ब्स द इकोलॉजिकल बॅलन्स. बघा ना तुम्ही, आता तिकडचे जे पक्षी होते ते नॅचरली ते कीटक खात होते, पण माणसाचा हावरटपणा, त्याला सगळंच प्रोड्यूस पाहिजे होतं, आणि त्याच्यामुळं मग त्यांनी त्या याच्यावर ते पक्षी ते कीटक मारायला ते इन्सेक्टिसाइड स्प्रे करायला सुरुवात केली, पण ते इन्सेक्ट्सच नाही तर त्या कीटकांबरोबर तिकडचे हे सुद्धा केले. नाव दिस ह्या डिस्टर्बन्सचा अजून एक उदाहरणच द्यायचं म्हटलं, नॉट डायरेक्टली रिलेटेड टू ॲग्रिकल्चर अँड ग्रीन रेव्होल्युशन, बट अगेन यू कॅन सी हाऊ मॅन हॅज बीन इन्स्ट्रुमेंटल इन डिस्टर्बिंग द इकोलॉजिकल बॅलन्स. म्हणजे इंग्रज लोक किंवा युरोपियन लोक, पर्टिक्युलरली इंग्रज लोक, हे ऑस्ट्रेलियामध्ये जेव्हा गेले तेव्हा त्यांच्याबरोबर इकडचं त्यांचं एक पाळीव प्राणी घेऊन गेले आणि तो म्हणजे ससा. रॅबिट वॉज अ व्हेरी कॉमन पेट ऑन द युरोपियन कॉन्टिनेंट. आता युरोपमध्ये तुम्ही पाहाल तर तिकडची फूड चेन, तुम्ही नॅचरल फूड चेन पाहिली तर देअर वर हॉक्स, म्हणजे एक हॉकला आपण छोट्या साईजचं गिधाड असंच म्हणूया. गिधाड मी ॲक्च्युली म्हणणार नाही, कारण वल्चर्स जे आहेत दे फीड ऑन डेड मॅटर. की आय वुड से हॉक्स डोंट फीड ऑन डेड मॅटर. हॉक म्हणजे एक प्रकारची आपण घार म्हणूया. की तर दीज हॉक्स यूज टू प्रे ऑन, त्यांचं मेजर खाद्य म्हणजे ससा. या व्यतिरिक्त ससा हा तिकडच्या कोल्ह्या लांडग्यांचंही मेजर खाद्य होता. पण हे सगळं बॅलन्समध्ये का राहायचं, तर सशाची प्रजनन क्षमता जी आहे ही प्रचंड फास्ट आहे, बिकॉज इट बिलॉंग्स टू अ रोडंट फॅमिली. रोडंट फॅमिलीचे अजून एक्झाम्पल्स द्यायचं म्हटलं तर उंदीर, घूस जे आहेत, ऑल ऑफ दीज बिलॉंग टू द रोडंट फॅमिली. या सगळ्यांची सुद्धा प्रजनन क्षमता फार फास्ट आहे. आता गंमत अशी झाली की ह्या स्टेबल एन्व्हायरमेंटमधनं युरोपच्या, त्याच्यातनं फक्त तुम्ही ससा उचललेला आहे आणि हा तुम्ही घेऊन गेलेले आहात ऑस्ट्रेलियामध्ये अगदी नवीन ह्याच्यामध्ये. त्या सस्याला तिथे मोकळं रान मिळालं, त्याच्यावर शिकार करणारे त्याचे शिकारी नव्हते तिथे, पण त्याची प्रजनन क्षमता तेवढीच राहिली. सो यू सी की से दे द नंबर ऑफ द पॉप्युलेशन ऑफ रॅबिट्स मल्टिप्लाइड लाईक एनिथिंग ऑन द कॉन्टिनेंट ऑफ ऑस्ट्रेलिया. अँड ॲज अ कॉन्सिक्वेन्स आता ससा हा असा बाकीच्या रोडंटसारखा, की आपण ज्याला म्हणतो ना की बिळं पाडणारा प्राणी आहे, तर त्याचे शेतामध्ये अतिशय नासधूस सुरू केली. आणि मग त्यांना रिअलाईज झाल्यावर कलिंग हा प्रकार सुरू केला. CULLING कलिंग ह्याचा अर्थ तुम्ही पाहिला तर एखाद्या प्राण्याची अंदाधुंद शिकार करणे इज कॉल्ड ॲज कलिंग. ती का करता तुम्ही, तर बेसिकली त्याचा नंबर प्रचंड वाढलेला आहे. कलिंग ही सश्याची अमेरिकेत होते. तुम्ही पाहाल की थायलंडला तुम्ही गेलात तर हत्तींची सुद्धा हत्तींचं कलिंग केलं जातं, कारण थायलंड ह्या देशामध्ये हत्तींचं प्रचंड पॉप्युलेशन आहे. माझा प्रश्न किंवा एखाद्या एन्व्हायरमेंटलिस्टचा असा प्रश्न आहे की तुम्ही सश्यांचं पॉप्युलेशन वाढल्यावर त्यांना मारून टाकताय, कुठे ऑस्ट्रिचचं पॉप्युलेशन जास्त झालं तर त्याला मारून टाकताय, कुठे हत्तींचं पॉप्युलेशन जास्त झालं तर त्याला मारून टाकताय, पण मानवाचं पॉप्युलेशन झाल्यावर तुम्ही एवढे शांत का बसता? इट इज सो व्हेरी अन ऑब्विस क्वेश्चन एस सर. सो एनिवे, कमिंग बॅक टू द फॅक्ट की मग हे कलिंग केलं जातं आणि हजारो ससे मारले जातात. दिस हॅज बिकम अ व्हेरी रेग्युलर प्रॅक्टिस एस सच. सो दिस इज बेसिकली वॉट हॅपन्स वेन यू डिस्टर्ब द इकोलॉजिकल बॅलन्स ऑफ नेचर. आणि हे सगळं होते. आता हे ऑस्ट्रेलियासारख्या श्रीमंत देशाला हे परवडत असेल, पण डेव्हलपिंग कंट्रीजमध्ये ह्या गोष्टींसाठी पैसे इन्व्हेस्ट करणं हे कितपत योग्य आहे हा सुद्धा एक प्रश्न निश्चितच राहतो. याच्यासाठी काय करता येईल, तर ऑब्व्हियसली इंटिग्रेटेड पेस्ट मॅनेजमेंट नी तुम्ही ऑप्टिमायझेशन करता, नॅचरल कंट्रोल्स इंड्यूस करता पेस्ट मॅनेजमेंट साठी अँड सो ऑन अँड सो फोर्थ. म्हणजे का नेमकं काय करायचं, तर यू क्रिएट ॲडवर्स वेदर कंडिशन्स फॉर पेस्ट्स अँड फेवरेबल कंडिशन्स फॉर नॅचरल एनिमीज ऑफ पेस्ट एस. म्हणजे आपण नागपंचमी जी साजरी करतो, दॅट इज बेसिकली अ रिस्पेक्ट दॅट द इंडियन फार्मर ऑर द इंडियन सोसायटी पेज टू द स्नेक, बेसिकली बिकॉज ऑफ द फॅक्ट दॅट a snake is a natural enemy of the mouse and he undir vagare je rahatat he shetkaryancha kutumbatna alelyana mahitis asel ki they are included in the pest because they harm the crops as such. Tar we have been following this as a natural or I would say a social practice, but जसं जसं शहरीकरण वाढलं तसं तसं लोक शहर वस्ती वाढत गेली, आणि अशी वस्ती जेव्हा फ्रिंज एरियाजमध्ये जाते तिथे मग साप साहजिकच निघणार आहेत. मग ते उन्हाळ्यात निघतील, पावसाळ्यात निघतील, आणि मग त्यांना मारलं जातं. मग हळूहळू हाऊ दिस इज बॅड, मग साप दिसला की मार, म्हणजे तो तुमच्या वाट्याला जातो नाही जातो, बट दिसला की त्याला मारायचं, अशी एक प्रथा प्रस्थापित झाली. आणि त्याच्यामुळे सापांचं पॉप्युलेशन हळूहळू कमी झालं. आणि व्हॉट हॅपन टू द रॅबिट इन ऑस्ट्रेलिया कुड इझिली हॅपन विथ द माईस पॉप्युलेशन इन 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 अ पर्टिक्युलर रिजन. इफ यू आर गोईंग टू रिमूव्ह द प्रिडेटर, ऑब्विसली दॅट ॲनिमल इज गोईंग टू मल्टीप्लाय व्हेरी व्हेरी फास्ट. एस पुन्हा द सोशल प्रॉब्लेम जो आपण म्हणतो, दॅट इट इज सेट कॅन बी सॉल्व्ह, ग्रीन रेव्होल्युशनचा सोशल प्रॉब्लेम जो आहे की तुम्ही गरीब शेतकऱ्यांना सबसिडी द्या, त्यांना लोन द्या, पण याचेसुद्धा काही विक्षिप्त प्रकार, म्हणजे लोन घेतलेल्या शेतकऱ्यांच्या आत्महत्या ज्या आहेत, दॅट इज अगेन अन इश्यू. सो एक सोशल प्रॉब्लेम तुम्ही सॉल्व्ह करायला जाता, तो दुसरा सोशल प्रॉब्लेम समोर उभा राहतो. ओके, देन वेगवेगळ्या ह्याच्या मॅनेजमेंट तुम्ही जर व्यवस्थित केल्या तर इकोलॉजिकल बॅलन्स तुमचा आहे तसा मेंटेन करायला बऱ्यापैकी सोपं जाईल. ग्रीन रेव्होल्युशन इन ॲग्रिकल्चर ड्युरिंग द लास्ट 20 इयर्स हॅज लेड टू डिक्लाईन इन प्रोडक्शन ऑफ पल्सेस. हा एक ॲडवर्स इम्पॅक्ट आहे की डाळींचं जे प्रोडक्शन आहे, पल्सेस म्हणा, बीन्स म्हणा, पीज म्हणा, म्हणजे लेग्युमिनस, आता हे का महत्त्वाचं आहे हे तुमच्या लक्षात आलं असेल. क्रॉप रोटेशनमध्ये हे जे क्रॉप्स आहेत, ओके, नॉट ओनली आर दीज अ गुड सोर्स ऑफ प्रोटीन विच इज रिक्वायर्ड, बट यू सी दॅट दीज आर कॉल्ड एज लेग्युमिनस, ओके, दीज आर कॉल्ड एज लेग्युम्स, these are called as legumes, legumes, okay, yancha jala apan roots mhanto, yancha roots madhe ek peculiar type cha bacteria asto ani ya bacteria mule nitrogen fixing, okay, nitrogen cha je praman ahe he mrudhe madhe vadnyacha ke praman he hota, mruda mhanje soil वाढण्यास मदत होते. आणि दॅट इज लुक्ड अपॉन ॲज अ व्हेरी हेल्दी, व्हेरी नॅचरल वे ऑफ एनरिचिंग द सॉइल विथ नायट्रोजनस कंटेंट. अँड दॅट इज वाय क्रॉप रोटेशनमध्ये एक सायकल ही लेग्युम प्लांट्सची असतेच असते. पण तुम्ही काय सुरू केलं की एका ठिकाणी सलग वर्षानुवर्ष मोनोकल्चर म्हणतात त्याला, व्हीटचंच कळ घेतलं, कारण त्याच्यातनं तुम्हाला कमीत कमी याच्यामध्ये जास्तीत जास्त फायदा होत होता. तुमचं सरकार तुम्हाला वेगवेगळी सबसिडी देते, त्याच्यामुळे तुम्हाला बाकीच्या ठिकाणी बघायला वेळ नव्हता. पण हळूहळू याचा ॲडवर्स इम्पॅक्ट व्हायला लागला. आणि नॉट ओनली डिड यू कम डाऊन डिक्लाईन इन द प्रोडक्शन ऑफ बीन्स, वी पल्सेस, पीज एक्सेट्रा विच आर ऑल कॉल्ड एज लेग्युमिनस प्लांट्स, बट यू सी दॅट दॅट लेड टू अ लॉस ऑफ से क्वालिटी ऑफ नायट्रोजन इन द सॉइल. अँड ऑफकोर्स त्याचा प्रोडक्ट जो आहे, प्रोटीनयुक्त आहार जो आहे, याच्यामध्ये सुद्धा कमतरता आलेली आहे. सो देर इज अ नीड टू ब्रिंग अबाउट अ चेंज इन द क्रॉपिंग पॅटर्न इन ऑर्डर टू प्रोटेक्ट द एन्व्हायरमेंट. एन्व्हायरमेंट द क्रॉपिंग पॅटर्न शूड कन्फर्म विथ द ॲग्रोक्लायमॅटिक रिजन्स. ओके, त्या एरियामध्ये नेमकं कुठला क्रॉप तुम्ही घेऊ शकता ॲग्रोक्लायमॅटिकली, म्हणजे तिकडची माती पाहून, तिकडचं क्लायमेट पाहून नेमकं कुठलं घेऊ शकता हे डिफाईन करा. नाही की अमुक एक ह्याची सबसिडी मिळते, अमुक ह्याला जास्त भाव मिळतो आहे म्हणून एखादा प्रोडक्ट तिथे घ्यायचा आग्रह करणे, के आणि मग त्याच्यासाठी केमिकल फर्टिलायझर्स वापरणे, त्याच्यासाठी केमिकल पेस्टिसाईड्स, ऑल यू गोन यूज ऑल दीज थिंग्स देअर अँड क्रिएट न्यू प्रॉब्लम्स ऑफ लँड पोल्युशन, वॉटर पोल्युशन, इकोलॉजिकल इम्बॅलन्सेस अँड सो ऑन अँड सो फोर्थ. So this in short is the whole history of what has been happening as agricultural practice for the last 10,000 years as far as human population is concerned. I will stop here for the day and we'll return back to our main screen. Okay, so if you have any additions etc., I have already posted the copy of this particular chapter. And it is time that very soon I would be assigning you topics for assignment. And we need to start coming up with various assignments as such. So in some time from now, I will give you questions just like I used to give it to you for climatology also. I have given you the reference material and you can write your answers using that particular reference material. You can use these slides also. Ya slides madla je material ahe, bahutek material he sagla tya yachatnach ghetlela ahe. Ani I would urge you to listen to these lectures also, because a lot of things that the examples particularly are not from the textbook, not from the reference book that we are using for this particular course as such. So ek changli grip yaila, you'll have to understand how things are related. Ata he biomagnification mana, eutrophication mana, culling je chi process ahe, he sagli udaharan je ahet hi tya pustakamadhe nahi ahet. So unless and until you go through these lectures, ani lectures tyat speed madhe aikayla havit asa nahi ke हे मी तुम्हाला डिलिव्हर करतो तेव्हा मी स्लो स्पीडने जातो. तुम्ही जेव्हाही पुन्हा ऐकता त्याच्या सेटिंग्समध्ये जाऊन तुम्ही त्याचा स्पीड वाढवू शकता. मला वाटतं हे मी मागेसुद्धा मी तुम्हाला सांगितलेलं आहे की नॉर्मल स्पीडच्या डबल स्पीडने सुद्धा ते ऐकू शकता, आणि जेवढा भाग तुम्हाला वाटतं की नाही हा महत्त्वाचा आहे, हा मला व्यवस्थित ऐकायचा आहे, तिथे परत नॉर्मल स्पीडला येऊन यू कॅन लिसन टू दॅट पर्टिक्युलर लेक्चर. सो आय एम स्टॉपिंग द रेकॉर्डिंग हिअर. ऑफकोर्स लाईक